the Computational Antibody Discovery Symposium, held on June 22, 2023, included a panel discussion during which the panelists provided their opinions and insights on five questions. The panelists were Jiye Shi, Victor Greiff, Sandeep Kumar, and Ben Holland, but not all of the panelists were able to grant permission for on-demand access to their content. For this panel discussion summary, my colleague Silvia Crescioli and I have anonymized their responses. Information that could identify the speaker was removed and responses were paraphrased, but the main points were retained. Please note, the fourth and fifth questions were answered by only one panelist. The first question was, what properties are more urgent to be able to design in silico? Binding specificity, developability, or something else?
So one panelist thought both specificity and developability were important, but more data are needed to aid in silico design efforts. A second panelist thought that more data across multiple properties are needed. In addition to getting more data to drive the AI and machine learning approaches, we also need orthogonal techniques. The combination of these tools will help us answer key questions. If required to pick one property, the panelists thought specificity was a key component. Can we name an epitope and design a specific antibody towards that epitope without any wet lab data? That would be the ultimate challenge. Thinking about specificity in a broader sense, can we engineer an antibody so that it cross-reacts with multiple species, but potentially not cross-react with other species? The fine-tuning of the specificity, both in terms of epitope and in terms of species, would be of most interest to us. Another panelist noted that computational approaches should be looked at through the lens of where they can help the most, and thought that how computational approaches are used may depend on the target. Companies that have difficult targets typically want certain specificity profiles towards particular epitopes more often than a particular developability profile. Thus, the current thinking may be that developability improvements can be achieved via standard techniques, but specificity may be better addressed with computational approaches. A fourth panelist was of the opinion that developability is as important as binding of the antigen, because if you don't have binding, you don't have a drug. But if you cannot make that drug in large quantities and in a reliable manner on a commercial scale, then you also don't have a drug. This panelist defines developability not only in terms of good biophysics, but also good pharmacology, immune safety, and therapeutic performance, which can be traced back to sequence and structural features of the antibody drug. So in this panelist's opinion, specificity and developability are equally important.
The second question was, what performance should computational antibody design achieve to improve upon established protocols?
So one panelist noted that for binding, we know that if we immunize a mouse or a human or we perform phage display, we can get binders at least for the easier targets. Where computational methods would really outperform experimental approaches is targeting just a specific epitope or cross-reacting with only certain species. Experimental protocols are a bit targeted, but can be a bit random. Computational approaches, if mastered well, can remove that randomness. A second panelist suggested that while different organizations have different needs and performance requirements, everyone wants better quality. The challenge then is to match time and money relative to established methods, but produce better results. In some cases, speed is highly relevant, such as in the development of fast followers, when there is a race for an exciting new target. A limited number of people might be interested in matching the speed and quality of an existing technique, but at a reduced price. Another panelist remarked that in antibody discovery, we have powerful experimental techniques to help us sample billions of antibody repertoires to extract binders. And this usually yields multiple antibodies with proper binding properties. We can then choose which ones have the desired properties and engineer them. The ability to generate antibodies quickly based on our design is also adequately addressed by experimental techniques. These are the benefits we enjoy in antibody discovery, but at the same time, it raises the bar for computational approaches to provide value in addition to what experimental techniques can provide. So there are two main approaches we can take. One is to leverage the powerful experimental techniques we have and ask the question, how do we use computation to create or design experiments that would provide more value to us? The other aspect is function prediction. Can we better model agonism, the functional effect of these antibodies, especially in the context of GPCR and other targets that are very difficult to screen? Those are the areas where computational approaches can really deliver above and beyond what experimental techniques can give us. Ideally, if we can do computation all the way through without generating experimental data, that's fantastic. But the reality is that we are probably better off leveraging both computational and wet lab techniques. A fourth panelist thought that computational approaches can help with targets more associated with cancer and other diseases where traditional approaches have not worked well. Experiments are needed, but traditionally the role of computation in drug discovery has been more of assisting nature, which is going to change to where computation plays an equal role. Then we can realize greater speed, better efficiency, and lower costs, but also greater scope in terms of expanding the druggable antigen target, being able to deliver, for example, antibody components intracellularly to target intracellular antigens. Computation has a significant advantage using AI or quantum computing to really diversify the antibody libraries we are making beyond what we see in the human or animal repertoire. This is another exciting place where computation can give a big contribution in antibody discovery.
The third question was, what are the biggest hurdles for computational antibody discovery to achieve its full potential, models, data, or something else?
One panelist noted that small changes can have a big impact on the antibody protein. So we need more mutational data. We need antibody mutational data sets where we can trace back how mutation changes both specificity and developability, and then match all of these with the structure. So we need much more structural data. Where should this data come from? We need experimental technologies that we can create these data sets, but at least in the public domain, they seem to be lacking so far. While we wait for these technologies to arrive, simulated data are a really good way to move forward. We need experimental technologies to validate our experimental approach. We need to get better in terms of data, technology, and statistics. A second panelist agreed, experimental technologies to generate data and for validation are coming along. For example, researchers generate data with traditional techniques, use phage display on a large number of antigens and tweak their lab processes. And rather than aiming for a small number of high quality candidates, they actually aim to learn the maximum they can from an experiment. Data is generated, but this data may not be publicly available. The validation technology is advancing, DNA synthesis technology is improving all the time, validating a million design is still a way off. But this panelist can see it on the horizon. A third panelist agrees that it's important to generate relevant high quality data. Calculating binding is a more accurate way, it's a hurdle, especially where there are two scenarios. One is multiple mutations in the CDRs. Can we predict binding affinity and how that's going to change? The second scenario is when the length of the CDR changes. What is the impact on binding? An additional hurdle is applying computational technologies in antibody design in a prospective way. Instead of ranking antibodies, saying that these are going to perform better than others, we can generate new antibody designs computationally, and that would require better binding free energy calculations. A fourth panelist noted that we need not just the data, but self-consistent data, especially for developability. We need experimental data where protocols are more or less identical, and then when differences are seen with the large number of antibody molecules, those differences can be then traced back to sequence and structure property. Also, the data should be available to anyone who needs it. Many times during the discovery process, we just collect the data, make PowerPoint presentations, go to team meetings, make decisions, and move on. Proper documentation and curation of the data in an accessible, interoperable, and reusable manner into databases is what we need. The third point is a cultural change. We need to enable digitalization and digital transformation. Then the data we collect in the lab is not just used for immediate purposes, but it can also be used across projects, cross-domains, cross-modality interpretation. So we then need to think about not just our lab scientists or bench scientists, but also data scientists. Can we make the data available to them in a way that they can use it? We need the infrastructure, we need the digital mindset, and of course, we need the data. So the fourth question was, how could industry and academia complement each other to solve the problem of computationally designing antibodies?
Collaborations, where decisions are jointly made regarding which data sets are generated and for what purpose, is going to bring the most value. Those conversations need to happen. Towards this end, one mechanism that is most useful for training purposes is the industry internship. Through this mechanism, graduate students and postdocs can be exposed to the challenges faced by industry, but also have access to industry resources and data sets as part of their training. Those internships have value regardless of whether the researcher ultimately decides to stay in academia, because the experience and appreciation of key challenges faced by industry can inform their future scientific endeavors. We should invest more in this training scheme, which helps to build bridges between academia and industry, and is thus well worthwhile.
The fifth question was, what roles does big tech biopharma have to play in development and adoption of computational antibody design paradigms?
Technology firms have deep knowledge of computational approaches and how to develop algorithms in a fast manner, which they can contribute as part of a virtuous cycle with big tech, big pharma, biotech, and academia all working together. This can be done in a pre-competitive space. The state of the data, though, is a challenge. Data from industry that can be shared with academia in a consistent manner is scarce, because historically, industry researchers do experiments make antibodies, produce drugs, but then they move on to other projects. Thus, the problem is not that industry doesn't want to collaborate with each other or academia. It is more that from the digital perspective, the data is not in a state where effective collaboration can actually occur without exposing everything, which leads to several intellectual challenges. In the pre-competitive space, the question is whether we can form a consortium where costs and data are shared and go from there. That type of an approach could really work and benefit all stakeholders. That concludes the panel discussion summary. We invite you to watch the next video, which includes the closing remarks made by co-host Andrew Buchanan, principal scientist within biologics engineering early oncology at AstraZeneca. Thanks for watching.